Welcome to Extreme Survival Caught on Camera. This stuff is gonna blow your mind. I'm gonna be sharing jaw-dropping footage of people in genuine life and death situations.
Surviving against all the odds.
And I'll be picking my favorite clip, my ultimate survivor. Let's see if it's your favorite too.
We're looking to the skies to prove that what goes up must come down.
G-force is horrendous. The force on the body is huge.
You can shatter vertebrae, shatter your pelvis, shatter your legs. Very often it's fatal.
So pay attention. Just might save your life. Statistics tell us that travelling by air is as safe as means of transport. But if you find yourself falling through the sky, you don't care about statistics.
When it comes to flying, there are no guarantees.
Holy crap.
Roughly half of all plane accidents occur during landing, so buckle up. And when there's no other way to avert disaster, the last resort for any pilot is the ejector seat. This Argentinian pilot is flying a lightweight, self-built plane, and he's about to hit trouble.
That aerobatics was just so amazing. He pulls whatever turn he pulls, and the wing falls off. He ejects. As he ejects, he flies out. Parachute comes out the back of the plane, brings it down under controlled descent.
I have never seen a plane with its own parachute. This is completely new for me. So this kit plane must be so light it can be supported by a parachute. How fantastic is that?
Very lucky, obviously, that pilot can now fly another day.
When I flew over Everest on one of these, I faced temperatures of minus 40 degrees, super strong jet stream winds, and often the most dangerous point of flying is takeoff and landing. So you're close to the ground, very little time to react. And this is something that Glenn Tupper found out in Peru.
With the ultimate aim of paramotoring over Machu Picchu, today they're flying over the Valley of the Incas. Glenn's flying in what might look like perfect conditions, but at nearly 4,000 metres, the mountains bring a hidden menace.
Glenn is flying at about 12,500 feet in altitude, so the air is much, much thinner. There's a lot of thermals going on. It's really tough to understand that there's turbulent air there. And this comes from experience that you can't see this. You know, the air all looks the same to us. We can see through it. If I was there, I'd look at those conditions and I would seriously consider packing my gear up and walking away.
After 30 minutes in the air, Glenn's biggest challenge is yet to come.
Now he's really got to consider whether he has a suitable landing area where he is at 12,500 feet in thin air, in turbulent conditions, or whether he has to fly further down and he has to make that judgment now. Now, if he's going to land in turbulent conditions, then he's really, really got to be on it.
Glenn goes for the riskier option of landing high up on the mountainside. Friend Matt is filming the action from the ground.
Out of nowhere, literally out of nowhere, I just started to drop.
Suddenly, from very clean air with his parachute cutting through there, he might get a downdraft on any one of those hillsides, which will make his rate of descent a lot faster than he's actually expecting.
Now, if he goes down with 30 kilos on his back, that will not end nicely for Glenn.
Everything went into slow motion. The only thing I can remember thinking about right before I crashed was, I need to do a parachute landing fall to stay alive. you put your feet together, your knees together, and you roll with the blow.
It's just this awful scream. We then see footage, his friends come to rescue him, and he's got the motor on his back.
Come on down! Come on down! Do you want a movie? No! Come on! I got this time. Oh, can you breathe? Yeah. Okay, dude. Okay, I'm on it, dude.
It hurt more than any pain I've ever experienced in my entire life.
When I see him like that, in that position with the motor on his back, my first thought is, you are going to carry the pain from this for a very long time, probably the rest of your life.
He's crying.
Matt runs for help.
He's hurt. He's hurt bad. He's really hurt. Oh, my God.
That was some of the most excruciating time for me, not knowing if I move, will I be paralyzed for life.
When there's fear of a spinal injury, the standard advice is not to move the victim.
Okay, my other arm. The bar is sticking down on my arm.
But the decision is made to carefully remove Glenn's paramotor. Thankfully, he's moving his head, a promising sign. An hour later, an ambulance arrives, and it's another hour's drive to the hospital. But x-rays show just a single fractured vertebra. That's all. Glenn is discharged that night.
I have to wear a brace around my torso for a couple weeks, they say, and then I'll be okay.
Despite the accident, Glenn made a full recovery. He's still paramotoring, but has not yet attempted Machu Picchu.
In the military, we often talk about train hard and fight easy. It just means when you face the big moments, you act decisively and calmly. My next death defier underestimated the importance of proper training, with disastrous results.
This lucky man has just invested over $50,000 in the ultimate boy's toy, a brand new helicopter.
It's his first day out. He's waiting for his instructor. I mean, how exciting can that be? But how stupid to start the thing without the instructor being there.
A helicopter is a dynamically unstable platform. Anytime you affect one control, that influences another one, and so you're constantly juggling.
The top rotor lifts the craft up and down and directionally, whilst the back rotor creates sideways forces, preventing the helicopter from spinning on its axis.
They have to be synchronized. It's not an easy thing to do, which is why you see the helicopter out of balance all of the time.
He's just learning how to fly this helicopter. He hasn't had any time in it. He just bought it, and he owns the helicopter, and he just ate the big one.
People run towards it. They all put themselves in danger because there was still power going to those rotor blades. Those blades could have fired up suddenly and maybe even chopped someone's head off.
Luckily, after that smash, the pilot made a full recovery. But even veteran pilots can get in trouble. They'll be thrown around like a rag doll in enough helicopters. To know it could be pretty frightening. My next survivor had thousands of flying hours under his belt, but when he finished his aerobatics display, he came in for hell of an ending.
You can pick up the basics of paramotoring fairly quickly, but helicopter aerobatics require a huge amount of skill and training. At the age of 75, British pilot Dennis Kenyon had over 50 years' experience in the cockpit. This display near Salt Lake City is his 1,223rd.
The pilot's clearly very competent. He performs some very precise maneuvers. He's hovering backwards and forwards, up and down.
So his next manoeuvre, the wing over, should be a breeze.
Misjudging the bottom of a loop is a really classic way for pilots to die. The speeds of aircraft are so high that even just grazing the ground can cause really dreadful injuries. You can shatter vertebrae, shatter your pelvis, shatter your legs. Very often it's fatal.
The desert heat changed everything for Dennis. The calculations for this move are based on elevation, air density, and weight of craft, including fuel. The ideal height for this helicopter to perform this manoeuvre under these conditions would have been 15 metres with a velocity of 95 knots. Dennis turned at 6 metres, doing only 80 knots.
Now, if the air is thinner, which essentially it is when it's hot, you've got much less to bite into with your blades. It's fine, he's going up, but as he's coming round, he's got less to bite into to make that crucial recovery.
I think once Dennis makes the decision to execute that maneuver at that height, he's essentially doomed.
Because the helicopter didn't go up in flames, Dennis survived with relatively minor injuries. Damaged vertebrae, a cut to his face, and bashed teeth. But being a true professional, the veteran aviator was even up for a quick interview.
The dull thing is that I've seen quite a few accidents over the years. And like everybody said to me today, their one concern is the pilot's OK. I was concerned about what I've done. You know, I messed up the airplane, I messed up the day.
Helicopter travel has proven to be one of the most dangerous modes of transport, with 70% of crashes resulting in fatality. If you're about to crash, adopt one of the brace positions. Bend forward, grab your ankles, and prepare for impact. Next, holiday terror in the skies.
It must have been absolutely hair-raising being in that balloon basket, not knowing when this ordeal was going to end.
An air show turns into a horror show.
Massive fireball, 1 second and he'd be dead.
And at the end of the show, I'm going to be picking my favourite clip. Because remember, this stuff can save your life.
Is action-packed and sometimes dangerous. I'm sharing incredible footage of near-fatal incidents that occur in the air. Later on, I'll be picking my favourite.
To hang around, literally, to see which one I choose.
Flying a CF-18 Hornet jet requires lightning-fast reflexes, something Canadian airman Brian Bews clearly possesses. One of the most difficult stunts is this, the High Alpha Pass, where the jet has flown very slowly at around a sixth of the normal speed, with the nose pointing upwards. Practice day at the 2010 Alberta Air Show in Canada, and Brian Bews was performing this manoeuvre.
I first knew that something was wrong when the nose dropped. I didn't have any engine indication, any alarms going off in the cockpit like you normally do.
Brian had no idea at the time, but his engine had failed.
He needs to make a decision. Can I land this aircraft safely, or am I going to die because whatever's going wrong is uncontrollable?
The jet was essentially out of control. So all I really could do at that point was eject.
Ejects within seconds of it crashing. Massive fireball, parachute comes up, and in the background, he lands. Crazy.
He ejects just 4 seconds before slamming into the ground, at around a hundredth of the average height of a parachute jump.
That ejection seat is an explosive. And you press that button, explosives happen, not just under the seat for the jet, but around the canopy. There's detonation cord all the way through the canopy. As he presses the button, that shatters, he fires out.
It's an explosive exit from the cockpit, which can affect your spine and your inner organs. Nobody wants to eject unless they really have to.
The G-force is horrendous. The force on the body is huge. He just looks up, which we all do when we parachute. We look up and we go, yes, she's open.
Ejected out of the jet, parachute opens up. Within a couple of seconds, I was back on the ground. So pretty overwhelming, not a lot of time to think about things.
Brian's only injuries were 3 compressed vertebrae.
1 second and he'd been dead, and he survives and he walks away from it. How amazing is that?
These holiday makers are looking forward to an early morning hot air balloon trip over the River Nile. This type of flight is based on a fundamental principle of physics.
Hot air makes you rise, cold air makes you sink. The whole point of a hot air balloon is to keep the balloon full of hot air.
But changing conditions bring challenges.
As the sun comes up, the ground begins to heat, and balloons are very susceptible to the thermals that are caused. So not only will it lift them up or knock them down, it can also move them sideways.
As they approach the built-up banks of the Nile, the balloon is flying low.
They swooshed past that building very, very closely.
The key to controlling any sort of aircraft, and particularly a hot air balloon, is to do everything gently and well in advance and to stay ahead of the aircraft. And once it gets into that rapid rate of descent, it's controlling you and you lose the ability to control it yourself.
Please watch.
The pilot begins to burn more fuel as the craft looks set to hit the water at speed.
He begins to get worried because now he's burning like mad to get out.
From her hotel balcony, British tourist Rachel Crossley begins to film the drama unfolding. Inside the basket, fear is mounting. Water is pouring in, and they're now hurtling towards a Nile River barge.
He hit one railing, then he hit the other railing, and it tipped. Luckily, no one was tipped out.
Oh.
He's got all this energy in the balloon, and it just shoots up really high.
Gee, gods.
It must have been absolutely hair-raising being in that balloon basket, not knowing when this ordeal was going to end.
Whew. It's coming down. It's going down very fast. So... Oh, no, 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 please, no.
Leaving the damaged barge in the distance, the balloon finally crash lands in a rice field. All 16 passengers escape serious injury.
I've jumped in and out of an awful lot of planes and helicopters and balloons, you name it. And the 3 words you never want to hear as a pilot are brace.
This airliner's landing gear has failed. The 220 passengers on board have been told to prepare for an emergency landing in Warsaw.
I just put my head down and I said, okay. I saw some ladies praying, crying, because everybody was scared.
Emergency services on the ground have sprayed the runway with fire retardant foam, and they're on red alert.
They would have had to counteract not having that landing gear by pulling out all the stops to break the plane, because you don't want a fast impact as it hits the runway.
The pilot only has one chance to get the landing right.
He has to land at his minimum speed and make sure his rate of descent is very gentle so that he can just slide it up.
Causes a lot of heat. Imagine that huge plane rubbing against the floor. It's incredible that that machine did not burst into a huge ball of flames.
But elation soon turns to panic as the ordeal isn't over yet. The plane could still explode.
I tried to get up and run, and somebody just pushed me back. Some pilot maybe were screaming, run, 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 and jump. It's gonna blow up, run as fast as possible.
Thanks to the efforts of emergency services, the situation is finally safe, and Alexander and his fellow passengers walk away. Although it's a terrifying prospect, the odds of being in a fatal plane accident on a major airline are slim. But if you're smart, you'll still read the safety card.
We all fly and we've all got kids or loved ones, and it just makes you remember what you need to do, and that is look down the plane, take in where the emergency exits are, make sure you read that brochure, because that brochure could save your life.
Woo! Let's get this baby down! Despite what you've seen, flying statistically is still the safest way to travel. It's just when it does go wrong, it often does it in spectacular fashion.
We've witnessed some escapes that wouldn't be out of place in a Hollywood movie.
It's now time for me to pick my favourite clip, and I reckon it's got to be Dennis Kenyon, literally running out of sky.
Dennis made what should have been a fatal mistake, but remarkably, against all the odds, walked away from the carnage. Here's a tip if you ever find yourself around helicopters.
Remember, stay away from the tail. Always approach from the front where the pilot can see you between 10 and 2. There's so much that we can learn from all these stories. So pay attention. Just might save your life.